make it work. Welcome everybody to the online Peace Science Colloquium. This will be the first, the last substantive one of our academic year, but we may have special additions later in the summer. I'm Emily Hankin Ritter, and I am the coordinator of online Peace Science Colloquia for the Peace Science Society International. And this is a colloquium designed to present new research, ongoing research that can use feedback to help publicize the research and get lots of people to weigh in on it and help get more and more of it published in great journals. So this way we can all learn more about peace science throughout the year, not just at the conference. Today we're going to have a presentation from Shanna Kirschner and Adam Miller, which is entitled, Does Peacekeeping Really Bring Peace? Post-War Violence Beyond Killing. We're also joined today as discussants by Michael Greig, who's a professor of political science at the University of North Texas. We have Susanna Campbell, who is an assistant professor of political science at American University. And we have Sabrina Karim, who is an assistant professor in the government department of Cornell University. And we're working out some technical difficulties, but we're gonna make it work. And before we get started, I just wanted to make mention of Will Moore, who passed away this week and has meant a lot to the Peace Science Society. And the Peace Science Society is going to continue to celebrate Will in a number of ways this year. But I just wanted to mention that in particular, this online colloquium directly builds on the colloquium that he started with Christian Davenport, the Conflict Consortium. It was his, he was a major player in starting online colloquia so that we could build community between senior and junior scholars and talk about work and make it better and share it with the world and do it with the technology available to us. And so Will was a real innovator for political science in this way. He did it before IPES did it. He did it before we did it, and before so many did it. And so we're going to keep on doing this and do it for a while. So with that, I'm going to turn it over for Shanna and Adam to get started.
Okay, great. Can you see the slides full screen?
Yes, we can.
Excellent. So good afternoon, and thank you so much for taking the time to talk about our project. We've titled this project, Does Peacekeeping Really Bring Peace? Post-War Violence Beyond Killing. And we are focused here on a question that there's been a great deal of literature on, which is whether or not peacekeeping works. And we are suggesting in this project that we're at a point where we know that peacekeeping does a lot of things really great, but we have no idea whether or not it actually has an effect on sort of non-lethal forms of violence. So not just killing, not just whether or not it sort of ends a war, but whether or not it really improves the quality of life of folks in war zones and recovering war zones in other really critical ways. In this paper, we are looking in particular at sexual violence as an especially pernicious form of non-lethal violence. We'll get into that more in a minute, but just to sort of preview our results, we find that peacekeeping actually is able to reduce sexual violence very significantly, but that there is significant variation across wars, and there's variation for according to the mission robustness, so how many troops and other personnel deploy, what types of troops and other personnel deploy, and the government and rebel forces respond very differently to the deployment of peacekeepers. So as I said, there's been a great deal of discussion of this question of whether or not peacekeeping works. And we had sort of an initial wave of work that was fairly critical and suggested that peacekeeping often did not do a very good job at keeping peace. in the last decade and a half or so, that has really shifted to a consensus that once we take account of the difficulty of the mission, the task that peacekeepers face and how tough that is, following sort of Fortna's work, most scholars have sort of converged on the view that peacekeeping actually works very well. We also have general convergence on two main types of mechanisms. One, that peacekeepers help to increase the costs of violence, and two, that they help to reduce miscommunication and prevent accidents from sort of spiraling out of control. All of these studies have focused on a set of really one of sort of three types of outcomes. In the short term, we have a set of work focusing on peacekeeping as being able to contribute to war termination or the duration of peace, so the time until a conflict breaks out again. And we also have a set of scholars more recently who are focusing on humanitarian outcomes like killing of both on the battlefield and more recently of civilians. And then we have a set of scholars who are thinking about this more long-term in what we often call the peace-building literature, and that is focusing on outcomes like democracy, stability, development, etc. So we want to suggest today that all of these things matter a lot, right? It matters whether or not peacekeeping, you know, reduces killing and all of that. But we don't know about its effects on other metrics of the quality of life. And so in this project in particular, we're looking at forms of non-lethal violence. So thinking about things like torture, kidnapping, intimidation, forced migration, and in the paper we're talking about today, sexual violence as an especially pernicious form of non-lethal violence that has very very significant both short and long-term effects on stability, on mental health, on physical health for its victims. When we talk about sexual violence, just very briefly, we're talking about abuses like rape, non-penetrating sexual assault, coerced undressing, forced prostitution, sexual mutilation, forced abortion, and sterilization, things like this. There's been a lot more attention paid to these forms of violence following, in particular, the conflicts in Yugoslavia and Rwanda and the role that sexual violence charges played in the tribunals following those conflicts, as well as a set of, I think, five cases that have come before the ICC where sexual violence has been one of the charges against the combatants. There's also been a set of relevant UN Security Council resolutions, notably 1325, focusing on women and peace and security more broadly. And then 1888, which was just in 2009 and mandated that UN missions have to actually address sexual violence when that is a feature of the conflict. The literature on sexual violence tends to converge around sort of two different types, sets of causes. One is that it's used instrumentally as a tool of population or demographic control, sometimes even as a feature of or a form of genocide. And then there's also a set of scholars who look at sexual violence as a tool socially, right? So to build unit cohesion, for example, things like that. So we expect that peacekeeping helps with all sorts of lethal violence. We also expect it to help to curb non-lethal violence, such as sexual violence. So we'll spend a few minutes delineating some of our mechanisms and why we think this applies as well to sexual violence, and then get into the data. So first, when peacekeepers deploy, there are essentially just more eyes on the ground. That includes peacekeepers. It also includes, you know, folks with NGOs, things like that, that are returning as the situation stabilizes. In addition, right, we know that peacekeepers help to reduce violence more broadly, and so that reduces a sort of fog of war effect we expect, and makes it just more likely that sexual violence is going to be publicized. There are also some secondary effects. Most notably, we think that as peace advances, we're going to observe social structures and norms, political institutions being reinvigorated and so in essence, that peacekeeping sort of helps to create the environment in which folks can better provide for their own security. DDR, disarmament and demobilization, are important parts of most, if not all, peacekeeping missions just about at this point. And that also means, as part of those processes, that combatants are going to be separated from the population more, at least in the short term, that they're going to be disarmed. And so they we reduce some of the means that they have and the ability to actually target people. And then finally, depending on where you come down on the causes of sexual violence in armed conflict, the incentives to use violence either as a tool to control the population or to reward or control fighters in some way is going to decline as conflict itself declines. So we expect to observe a fairly straightforward effect there that peacekeeping reduces sexual violence. Second, missions vary a lot. We think about this as robustness, right, which is a continuum, you know, anywhere from 10 people on the ground up to about almost 30,000 in terms of what we observe in our data. There's also variation in the composition between troops, police who are serving lots of different functions, whether they're acting as sort of military police in refugee camps, whether they're working with local police forces on training, sometimes working in urban areas, actually providing security. We also have observers, which sometimes are serving what we could think of maybe as a traditional first generation peacekeeping role, where they're literally just observing the party's compliance. But observers also sort of in this category, there are folks like election observers, right? And so we expect that more robust peacekeeping missions are going to work better, right? In terms of size, there are more people on the ground. They'll be better able to detect violence. And in terms of composition, the more troops you have, followed by then police and then least observers, the better able they're going to be to impose costs for folks who commit violence. Third, we sat down and thought about you know, the different groups of combatants, and as we were thinking about how they might respond, we came up with, you know, about 3,000 different possibilities, and those led us to predictions in very opposite directions about whether or not the government will respond more significantly than the rebels or vice versa. You know, this sort of boiled down to the fact that they have different relationships with the international community. They have different needs for civilian support or relationships with the civilian population, and the stakes in the conflict are different. But in terms of thinking about a specific direction of the relationship, we couldn't we didn't have strong priors about which way that would go. And we came up with some very plausible possibilities going lots of different directions. So we really just expect that it will be different for the two sort of sets of combatants, two different types of combatants, whether or not you're the incumbent or not the incumbent. Okay, so we test all of this on a data set. It's monthly dyadic data on 40 African civil wars, 89 to 2009. That leads us to an N of about 18,500. And so because this is monthly data and dyadic data, some of the conflicts actually have hundreds, if not thousands, of observations. But it's particularly fine-grained in terms of variations in both sexual violence and the composition of the peacekeeping mission. The dependent variable is from Cohen and Nordos, the prevalence of sexual violence, that data set, the SVAC data. And the independent variable is the peacekeeping forces, both the size and composition. We control for two different types of or groups of controls. One is focused on the conflict environment, so essentially how difficult the peacekeeper's task is. And then second is the determinants of sexual violence, some common ones that occur in the literature that we think are likely to influence that. Okay, so you have hopefully read the paper. I'm not going to go into the results in, you know, excruciating detail, but just to highlight a couple of things here. So you can all see this table. And I just want to highlight that The coefficients for most of our key variables are in the predicted direction for reducing violence. Some of them are more significant than others for our first models, which just focus on either the probability of any violence or the level of violence, the prevalence of violence that's occurring. So to highlight a couple of these in more easily interpretable fashion, we find that peacekeepers have a really dramatic effect on the probability of any violence at all. This is really massive. What you can see here, can you guys see my little arrow? Yes, okay. So what you can see here is that by the time we get up to even, 5,000 to 7,000 peacekeepers, the chance of any violence at all occurring drops off really dramatically. The level of violence also drops off. So in conflicts where we don't drop down to zero violence, we are still much more likely to observe a decline in the prevalence. So from, for example, massive violence to sort of medium levels of violence, moderate violence to just occasional incidents, that sort of thing.
2 minutes.
Oh, okay. All right, I can do it. Okay. all right, so the government and rebels also respond very differently. And I just want to highlight one thing here. Again, the full results are in the paper. So the government responds very quickly to the deployment of peacekeepers. And you can see this is a very steep curve increasing to no violence. The prevalence of violence on the other side also declines sharply. The rebels respond much more slowly, but they do respond. We can go into that more if we need to. So in conclusion, we find that peacekeepers do reduce sexual violence, and they do so by a lot. However, their effectiveness varies across conflicts. In general, when we have conflicts where we would expect peacekeepers to have a fairly easy task, and there's not a lot of sexual violence to start with, they are very, very effective. But they're also pretty effective in our sort of average conflict. And even in the most difficult cases, they make a difference. Even though there is still sexual violence occurring in those cases when peacekeepers deploy, they do significantly reduce the level. We also find that the government is much more responsive than rebels, as I said. We think there are a number of possible reasons for this, ranging from the difficulty of sanctioning rebels, whether or not you really have much leverage over them, to possibly the regional dispersion of the incumbents and the challengers. But we also want to note from a normative perspective that because the government is committing the vast majority of violence in most conflicts, this is sort of the most important effect to observe in a sort of policy standpoint. In terms of variation within missions, troops have the greatest effect. The effect for police and observers is much more mixed. And again, we think that there may be regional variation going on there, helping to explain that. I'm happy to talk about that, or Adam can talk about that in the Q&A if you want us to go into that more. We also just want to point out that troops are basically doing sort of one type of thing, right? They're providing security on the ground. And police and observers are fulfilling lots of different functions, only some of which have anything at all to do with sexual violence. And so we wouldn't necessarily always expect them to be providing that security on the ground. There's also significant variation in mandates as to how, whether or not sexual violence is in there, and then how the peacekeeping mission prioritizes its, 10, 20, 30 different goals. And so if they're not really prioritizing dealing with sexual violence, we wouldn't expect a huge effect. And then finally, the national contingents that are part of the peacekeeping mission also prioritize differently within their sectors. And so that can affect as well the effectiveness. So, okay. I will stop sharing now. Thank you. We look forward to your feedback. Funders to thank here too.
All right. Thank you, Shanna and Adam, for this research. And with that, I'm going to open it up for comments, questions, critiques, suggestions, friendly notes, etc. Susanna, let's get started with you.
Okay, great. Shanna, I was more convinced by your presentation than I was by the paper. And I think that what's really interesting is that in your presentation, you really focused it down, where the paper is still kind of playing with a few different ideas. So I think what I really like about this paper, and I would encourage you to kind of take this hook, is I really like that you're looking at alternative measures for positive peace. That the problem and the main critique of a lot of the peacekeeping literature is that it focuses just on battle death thresholds and therefore doesn't capture a lot of what peacekeeping is actually trying to do, right? And then you go to the Doyle-Lansam-Banas polity score measure, right? Which also is a very blunt measure, but you're capturing much more fine-grained data and change in violence at the local level, although you do cross-national. So I think this is huge and really important, and I would play that up, right? So, and even in kind of how you begin, because you ask, you know, you start off saying, does peacekeeping work, right? But that's, you're not actually answering that question. I mean, the question that you're answering is, you know, we know that peacekeeping works for the behavior of combatants themselves and how they relate to one another and in how they relate to the political process, right? But does peacekeeping actually have an effect on the ground in other ways? And so the problem is that you kind of need to decide what effect you're talking about. And so as I was reading this, I said, well, there are multiple ways that peacekeeping could actually have this effect. One, normatively, that even you could argue that possibly the presence of peacekeepers, even if they're not in the particular locale, has a kind of deterrent effect, right? That training, that patrolling, that peace enforcement fighting, that, you know, community development programs that accompany peacekeeping, that the SSR, security sector reform, cantonment, that awareness raising through community sessions of awareness raising that happen or through radio, all of these potential things could have an effect. And I think that one of my major issues with a lot of the peacekeeping literature is that it talks only about troops, right? Whereas actually alongside peacekeepers, there's a lot happening. The deployment of peacekeepers, as you alluded to, gives the opportunity for a lot of other actors to become active, both those within the multidimensional peacekeeping operation, right, which has a lot of civilian staff as well, but also NGOs and donors and lots of other actors. The other thing is that you have a finding in relation to robustness, where you say that, well, the more robust peacekeeping troops actually seem to have a greater effect. But the problem is that robustness also means that you have more attention from Security Council members. So is that just that Security Council members and as donors are actually applying a greater pressure? And I know that, you know, if you wanted to spend a year more on this project, you know, then there's lots of things that you could do, including some field work and case studies and lots of stuff to kind of unpack this. But in the short term, I wonder if there is a way to even take your findings in relation to, you know, the hard, the medium, you know, the difficult, the not as difficult, and the easy cases, and really take a case of that, because that's very interesting. And I think there's a really nice theoretical story there that says that, well, we would expect in cases where you have a kind of normative alignment between what's happening within the country and between the idea of that peacekeepers are bringing in terms of reducing violence more generally. In those easier cases, it makes sense that you wouldn't need a lot, right? That there would be an effect maybe through all these different mechanisms. And in medium cases, you know, maybe it would be a little bit more difficult, but there's an effect. And somehow kind of, I know you use Liberia as your case, but if you could find either cases or some way of diving into these different results here to give us some idea of the mechanism. And I think it's and Emily, I'm going to stop in a second because I know other people. It's also a question of equifinality here, right? There are many paths to the same outcome. And so to what degree are you okay telling that type of story? And I think that you can tell that type of story if you're clear on the paths that you think are most important. right? And this may offer a venue, a kind of vehicle for actually telling that story by talking about these three types of contexts. I'll hit on two more points and then stop for now. I think the 2009 cutoff, I think, is slightly problematic because a lot of the normative work on protection and on and a lot of the kind of more egregious instances of violence against civilians at least have occurred after that. So South Sudan just kept on coming back to me. So how do you address that? And I would love to see this at the subnational level. I'm guessing that's not possible, but this is really a subnational effect. And so if there's any way to kind of pick up what's happening at that level, then I think that your findings could be even more robust and interesting. Okay, that's it for me for now.
So that was a lot, and we're gonna have them respond before we move forward.
Okay, so thank you very much. Yes, there's a lot here. I think definitely, you know, our data, we're pulling data from other folks, right? And that cuts off in 2009. But this is part of a larger project that we are trying to expand both temporally and geographically, as well as in terms of the types and forms of abuse. And so I think that's definitely a very valid concern. I like your suggestion about maybe thinking about adding in more case data or looking at sort of the variation in, I guess, types of cases, conditions on the ground, and seeing if we can get at things there. So. I had one question for you. Can I ask a question?
Of course.
Yes. Okay. So you started out by saying that you thought that the presentation was much more focused than the paper. And I'm wondering if you could, I think it would be useful for us if you could maybe spell out some of the ways that you felt like the paper was too all over there.
No, I think it's all the suggestions that you just made.
Sorry. So I think that because the paper reads like you're trying to figure out what's going on, right? To me, that's what it reads like. And it's understandably, you have these, you know, understandably, you have these results and you're trying to figure out what's going on. So I think that both in the intro and in the theory, you know, the theory, you just need to kind of take it and say, this is, you know, these are our hypotheses, but in the I think the theory section has a long lead-in before you get to the hypotheses, and you actually don't need that long lead-in. But also in the discussion section, really kind of, you know, take a stand on some mechanisms here, right? And then I would flesh that out first, and then I would go back and rework the intro. Because I think once you flesh that out, the intro and how to frame it will be super clear, because you'll say, actually, we're not just asking how does peacekeeping work. We're asking what are the ways in which peacekeepers actually lead to reductions in non-lethal violence. That's a hugely important contribution. And I would really encourage in doing that, not just talking about peacekeepers, although that's what you measure, but really talking about multidimensional peace operations. Because that's what's going on, and those are the actors that act on some of those other mechanisms that you talk about. I'll leave it there, if that's helpful.
Sabrina wants to add to that, and so does Michael. So let's see if we can hear Sabrina. You want to unmute yourself?
Yes.
Yes!
Yay! I decided to restart my computer. So sorry everybody, for being the problematic child.
No problem.
Okay, so I think my comments are related to Susanna's with regards to the theory part and the mechanisms. So I also found it. So let me just say the paper is great, and I think it's a really important topic, and I'm glad that somebody is taking it up, because it's a big feat to look at non-lethal violence, and this is a good first take at sexual violence, looking at sexual violence. So. I think that the framing of peacekeeping effectiveness might not also be the right way to go, just because effectiveness is, you know, you kind of define it and has been defined as ending conflicts. And so your theory is actually very much about how conflicts end and not really about reduction of violence. So I would try to maybe streamline the theory to talk about how we should see sexual violence, you know, minimal levels of sexual violence instead of how conflict ends. So the mechanisms should focus more on the dependent variable, which is sexual violence, rather than conflict ending. Like, I don't think that we needed to go into the bargaining stuff at all, really, unless one of your pathways is that ending conflict allows for sexual violence to also end, which is one pathway. Right, but actually, if we want to look at Dara's work, you know, you might want to talk about how peacekeeping affects unit cohesion or cohesion within militaries or cohesion within rebel groups, and a number of other pathways for why we see variation in sexual violence instead of conflicts ending. So I would suggest kind of maybe reworking the theory section to tie into more directly tie into the dependent variable, which is sexual violence. I also thought with regards to mechanisms that there's different pathways with if we're talking about within conflicts or in the post-conflict phase, right? So peacekeeping looks very different if there's an ongoing conflict than if it does after a conflict ends, once there's a ceasefire or once there's a negotiated settlement. So during conflict, I think you're absolutely right that the military plays a big part, but they play a big part in reducing all types of violence. Whereas in the post-conflict phase, I think the mechanisms are more related to state building. So the things that Susanna was talking about with the NGOs and the civilians and the police that are rebuilding the state institutions so that they can address sexual and gender-based violence. So I couldn't tell from your data description if you're looking at a few post-conflict years or not, or if they're all conflict years. I think some clarification on that would be helpful. And then to tie the theory to conflict or non-conflict or both, however the data is described. Wanted to bring up just one new point. I have a number of other points, but one that I thought was particularly important was there's no discussion on peacekeeping perpetrated sexual violence. So there's no commentary on sexual exploitation and abuse at all. And I know that that's not the focus, but it does need to be addressed because there's a potential for a substitution effect, right? So instead of women being targeted by government forces, now it might be peacekeepers, so you might have a substitution. And I think it's just something to address that's important. And then just lastly, really quickly, the government finding. So I think you need to consider the fact that, so two things. One, the conditions under which peacekeeping missions are actually going to places where there's high levels of wartime sexual violence. So here you might just need to cite, so in my book, Equal Opportunity Peacekeeping, we talk a little bit about the fact that peacekeeping missions do end up going to places where there's higher levels of wartime sexual violence. So you can maybe just cite, you know, I don't know if you need to go into it in depth, but just the idea that there's kind of a selection issue. So governments are gonna let peacekeeping missions in, going to maybe cease violence. So just something to think about and address. I'll leave it at that.
That was also a lot.
Sorry. I'm just glad my microphone's working.
Used it up.
All right, well, thank you for those comments. There's a lot to unpack there, and there's a lot of really useful stuff for us to include. First, I really like your point about these sort of mechanisms between troops being more important during conflict as opposed to after. With regard to ceasefires and the state of the conflict, we obviously include that as a control, but it could be a way for us to maybe go into more discussion to separate out perhaps looking at the separate unit makeup of peacekeeping forces in the different times specifically to see if that changes the results we're getting on the effectiveness, particularly of police and observers in conflicts, because that could be very interesting to look at. I think you're right. And on the point of not including a discussion on the peacekeeping perpetrated violence, I think we acknowledge it very briefly at some point in the paper. But it is a problem. We've seen a lot in news and reports coming out from current peacekeeping operations saying that there have been these problems. There is a concern of perhaps there being a substitution effect, but I think we're confident that the effects that we're seeing are so robust that we haven't seen that largest. We have seen sexual violence perpetrated by peacekeeping units, but not on the scale of wartime sexual violence in conflicts. obviously that's something that we're going to, I mean, the community will need to get data and information on, and that's difficult to do. But I think there are people currently working on that right now. And then once that comes out, it will be easy to include in our further research.
Michael. Oh, wait. Shanna, did you?
I just had a quick question. So Sabrina, that last comment about whether or not governments let peacekeepers in when they already intend to curb violence is particularly intriguing. And I think you're probably onto something there. So we control for the violence during the conflict itself and sort of the trend in the violence. Can you think of anything else we can do that might help to address that?
Yep, so this is like the selection problem, and I mean there's no good way around it. I think if you can just demonstrate that peacekeepers are going into countries where there's high levels of government and rebel, well, actually really more government, then maybe you can just leave it at that and just kind of punt the rest of the problems associated with it. But and if I remember correctly from the graph in my book, I think that is actually what I can't remember what we find actually. This is a very small part of, I mean, it, yeah. So, and I don't have a copy of my book with me in my office, but if you can cite that or maybe just do the analysis yourself just to see if peacekeeping missions are going to countries with high levels of government perpetrated sexual violence, just to demonstrate that you did look at that selection.
Mm-hmm. Michael.
Okay, so I had similar reactions to the others. I think just kind of in general, I thought kind of I liked the paper a lot. I actually thought that the pitch of the paper, that one way that maybe you might think about framing the paper is to more fully connect your findings here to kind of long-term consequences, because there's a pretty clear connection between sexual violence and peace and reconciliation efforts. And you talk a little bit about them, but you know, my sense in reading it that is, if you could kind of pitch it that way more up front of the paper, I think you can probably sell the paper at a better place. So that was my immediate reaction. And I also thought that the comments from Susanna, I had a similar thought in terms of the having a deeper sense of whether the mechanism at work is more of kind of an enforcement mechanism or more of an observational kind of mechanism would help, because immediately as I was reading it, I was thinking, well, what about NGOs that are working alongside these missions? What sort of effect are they having? And I know the others had similar comments. The big thing that jumped out at me was actually something that you say in the theory section that I thought was a really pretty exciting idea in terms of thinking about this, that you don't actually test. And I kind of wrestled with whether this is something to be that annoying reviewer that suggests you test something else in a paper, or whether I'm the helpful reviewer that suggests the next paper. So whichever one's the more charitable one, I want that label. But you talk about the role of institutions and the status of women in society. And the way that you talk about it in the theory section, it in a lot of ways begs for you to actually test that and look at an interactive effect between peacekeepers and either the normative experience of women pre-war or pre-war institutions, and how those interact with not only peacekeeping, but distinct forms of peacekeeping. Because you make a really good argument that this isn't just peacekeepers being on the ground, that there's something else going on there. And so when I was looking at your results, I was kind of hoping to see that. And that struck me as something that really could kind of deepen the contribution of what you have here and be more than just deploy more peacekeepers. And I think that would also kind of feed in to the comments about the selection effects as well. That so I think I'll kind of leave it at that. But that those are the things that struck me immediately.
Shanna, Adam.
That's super helpful. Thank you. I have some ideas, just as you're talking about ways to maybe get at that sort of pre-war institution. So thank you. And clearly we need to talk more about what we think our mechanisms are.
I've got Sabrina.
Cool. No, yeah, I think that's an interesting notion to think about that interaction, actually. If you, I'm going to make another pitch here. If you need data on gender equality stuff, I'm happy to help you think about it, because Danny Hill and I are working on a latent variable scale on women's institutional rights, if that's helpful at all. I was just going to bring up another thing a little bit unrelated, which was, if you decide to break this up into conflict versus post-conflict, or even think about looking at post-conflict and the peace-building and state-building aspect, I think it's going to be important to note that the data set, so SVAC, is really good at wartime sexual violence because it looks at the reporting of wartime sexual violence. But once the war ends, there's actually it's really bad. It doesn't do a good job of picking up the levels of sexual violence because it's not as newsworthy and it's not as report worthy. And so you are not picking up on a lot of different types of sexual violence that you might see, which is non-stranger perpetrated. So it's very possible that sexual violence stays the same after war, and we're just not picking it up from SVAC.
Yeah.
And so, then it might just be good to focus on the conflict for that reason. Otherwise, you might want to just address this latter point. Even though a lot of the mechanisms regarding police and civilian and NGOs relate more to the post-conflict part. So I don't know. It's going to be a choice that you have to make, I think. I did want to dispute also this idea that I'm just going to push back a little. There are actually really high levels of, it's not sexual violence, but transactional sex between peacekeepers and women that go on when peacekeepers arrive. So even though it's not the same thing, there's something else going on that I think just warrants some kind of a small discussion, at least.
Mm-hmm. John and Adam. Oh, we got a two-finger from Susanna.
I'll go after they respond. That's fine.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, thank you. I mean, just quickly, yes, we recognize that peacekeepers do commit, significant amount of sort of sexual abuse of various forms. And we have, as I think Adam said, we allude to that briefly, but we'll definitely think about beefing up that discussion a little bit. So.
Susanna.
So, and I would, I guess, I don't tend to make a clear post-conflict-conflict distinction because most of the countries that I work in and study actually end up having both happen simultaneously. And I think maybe to address the data issue that Sabrina raised, you could actually take out those that are clearly post-conflict, right? And then allow yourself to focus in on those that are kind of in this intermediary stage, which will probably be a lot of the countries that you're dealing with can fall within that stage. Because you do actually have a lot of NGO activity and even development activity in the midst of war. And, you know, peacekeeping operations trying to do both war fighting and peace building at the same time. And so, and I think that in terms of mechanism, I really don't think that you're going to find one specific one. But if you can find a nice theory that you can hold on to, and not your theory, but like a theory where you're bringing in some really interesting theoretical explanation about what leads to reductions in sexual violence, right? And Sabrina, I don't know if you've come across that in your work, but for me, that would fill a gap that you have. If even whether it's a theory on psychology, whether it's a theory on, you know, some kind of naming and shaming or something where it's like, the presence of observers in one way or another can have a behavioral effect, that would actually solve your mechanism problem because you could offer something theoretically that explains something that you're not able to explain.
You want to respond?
Yeah, thank you for that. I think we have heard a lot about mechanisms and we definitely need to focus in on that. And we'll hopefully be able to find some clear theories that point in a certain direction, although there will be many, but hopefully we can find a real good one for the paper.
Sabrina, you wanted to follow up.
I just had a two-finger really quick. So maybe when, for example, based off of what Susanna said, one example, if you want to go back to the social cohesion stuff, could be that, you know, when peacekeepers come, a lot of their job is to professionalize the security forces, especially on the government side, right? So you are, through security sector reform, creating this cohesion that wasn't there before among security forces, for example, right? That was one thing, one mechanism that I thought of.
I've got two fingers from Susanna.
So just to support that, the one case where I know I did an evaluation in Burundi, and it was actually the cantonment of the armed forces that led to reductions in violence, right? Against the population. So it was just that they weren't living in the communities anymore. So it can be this very kind of easy mechanism of really DDR, but it's not just DDR, it's also SSR. It's a focused on the reform of the security forces, which would explain why the government itself has a stronger effect.
Do you need to respond? Okay, I have an open queue.
Well, I will
throw to Michael, and I'm sorry, go ahead. Okay, Michael, and then Shanna, and then Sabrina.
So my comment's just quick. The one thing I would say is I thought the presentation versus the paper, the presentation of your dependent variable was a lot clearer in your presentation than in the paper. It took me a while to wrap my head around exactly what your dependent variable looked like. I understood the logic between using the logit versus the multinomial logit, but I think it could have been a little bit clearer in terms of exactly what the construct of the dependent variable looks like.
Okay, Sabrina?
That's a two finger. I was wondering about the monthly versus yearly, because SVAC is yearly. So did you aggregate up to the year for that? So if so, is there enough? I mean, why use monthly? Because there's no variation. I was just curious about that.
So we do have the monthly peacekeeping data, and we wanted to exploit that variation because there is very, very significant variation in deployments.
Sorry, can you just describe how it's aggregated? Okay, so you have the monthly, but in order to get, so what does one line look like?
So the line is, it would be, so, you know, side A is, you know, X force, side B is X group. Here's what each side is committing, right? And that's, right, we just take the whole year, right? And so there's sort of 12 iterations, right, of but that. Like, and then, sorry?
It would be like 0, 1, 2, 3. Wait, it's 1, 2, 3 for yep. That, for all of those observations though, right? Because there's no variation by month on SVAC.
Yes, yeah, but the peacekeeping varies a lot, and so we wanted to use that.
Okay.
Yeah.
Susanna and Michael both have two fingers on this. Let's do Susanna first.
Can you code civilian? Because you only code the military, like the peacekeepers and the police, right? In your peace, so do you also code civilian personnel in peacekeeping operations?
We are using, so it's the data from, I think it's Jake Katman's originally, the data, and it has troops, police, and observers. So the observers includes both like sort of military observers, but also civilian observers.
So, but in doing that, what you're doing is you're leaving out, you know, the kind of often thousands of staff in the mission who actually end up doing a lot of the softer work outside of the peacekeepers, right? So the kind of multidimensional nature, because the mission itself is not just peacekeepers and observers. There are a whole lot of other actors doing this kind of work. So,
yes.
That, and I guess this was also my monthly question. So even if you have a month lag, mm-hmm. right? But what kind of effect, when peacekeepers are deployed, then often they sit around for a while anyhow before they actually go out to the community. I'm just kind of thinking about the mechanism at play mm-hmm. here. So whether the monthly actually gets you that much leverage when sometimes they can just sit around in their barracks for months on end, right? But two, that you've got fine-grained data on one hand in terms of the peacekeepers and the observers, but you have no data on the civilian personnel, which also tells you a lot about how the mission is functioning.
Yeah, so that data, we need maybe to go back and look at it again and maybe get in touch with him. It does include some civilian personnel, and I'm not sure, I guess, exactly what the rule is for. It's not entirely clear in sort of the original data description, I guess, who does and doesn't get included. We did play around with different lag times up to a full year. And, you know, the results are similar, right? Obviously, there's minor variations, but so.
Michael.
Just going back to Sabrina's point, just to see, to make sure I understand the structure of the data. So if thinking about a hypothetical peacekeeping deployment, you have yearly data on sexual violence. If you have a mission that becomes much, much more robust in November of a year, it sounds like your data is structured so that the coding for that entire year, for the subsequent months, for November and December, when you have the large, robust peacekeeping mission, would essentially be penalized for the fact that you would have lots of sexual violence during the current year before the deployment, but those peacekeepers wouldn't have had the opportunity to essentially manage that violence. Is that a fair understanding of what you've done?
Oh, we can't hear you.
Sorry. Okay, so I think, let's see. Yes, essentially. The problem is that all of the sexual violence data is coded from annual reports. And so I think, you know, I don't know how we would get better data, right? I mean, these data are already so hard to get even at the annual level. But yeah, I mean, there's sort of a lag in when what's happening on the ground catches up to the data, right? Yeah. Do you want to add anything, Adam? No. Okay.
I'm curious if the discussants would talk a little bit clearly. I'm not getting the heart of what you think is the inferential concern about the monthly unit of observation here. Michael.
Yes. My concern is that, right, so for every month in that particular year, you have the same SVAC score. So it doesn't matter if within that year, you, like Michael was saying, if you see the robustness change, you're not picking up on that. So even for that same year, even if there was a change, it could go either way, you're still coding it as this. There's no variation on the dependent variable. So I don't, it within each year, right? So I'd, yeah.
Michael?
Yeah, the same response. So you have no variation in the dependent variable, but you have variation in the key independent variable.
Wouldn't that bias against finding something, right? It should mean that the standard errors are much wider and you'd have much more variance and wider confidence intervals, right?
Yeah, I guess I just am trying to understand like what added value there is from doing it monthly versus not. And I would, if possible, I think it would be good to put that in there as an appendix, okay, just to show like, you know, what the added value is of doing that.
Mm-hmm. One finger, two finger.
Yeah, sure, go ahead.
Some number of fingers. I guess, so my instinct is, you know, the main data person here, was that we have all this variation on peacekeeping and I don't want to lose it by just taking like the average deployment. Do we take the deployment at the end of the year, at the beginning of the year, right? And so I didn't want to lose that. And so I guess it would be useful. I am not a methodologist. It would be really useful if you guys think you could give us thoughts about whether or not we need to do something about that, whether or not we need to move to annual data. That was sort of the logic, right? Is we didn't want to lose that variation on the peacekeeping.
Michael.
So, yeah. So I don't immediately think that the monthly approach is fatal. I think maybe my advice would be, because you're right, there are trade-offs if you move to the yearly level for to deal exactly with the scenario that I described, that the peacekeepers change over the course of the year. But maybe be a little bit more specific in terms of what the trade-offs are to the reader, why you settled on the monthly analysis and that creates, but why those are less bad than, because you may well, you may have bigger problems with the changes in the mission across time.
So one suggestion might be to run, I mean, I know you want to get this out sooner than later, but to run four different models. So the one that you have, and then three at the yearly level. So take the highest troop or police average, the average, and then the low count, which then actually might get to some of your theory as well, right? So you could show that, you know, at the low end versus the high end, if there's any change, I guess that wouldn't matter. Never mind. Not. I guess it doesn't contribute to your theory, but at least for maybe not four then. Maybe just two. Maybe either just choose the average or the highest number, and then just see if there's any difference, and then choose one or the other. I guess.
Maybe come up with a measure that captures variance within a year. So you could either do the average, but include an interaction that notes when there's a significant amount of change within a year. Or you could actually calculate the variance and then run a model in which you draw a random sample from the variance and mean of each year, right? It sounds complicated, but it's not that hard of a loop to do. And so that could be a way to get at it if you are convinced that the variation is really important but would rather have an annual model. Probably the first option would be easier. I'm not sure that it's conceptually better, but Michael.
Yeah, and this might be kind of crude too, but you could even do something like kind of a weighted average of the peacekeeper size that's weighted by time. So if you have a large mission for a long period of time, that then gets smaller for a short period of time, weight it that way. That might get at it as well.
Two fingers from Susanna.
Well, that brings up another issue that I was thinking, is that you would expect the effect to be more important over time as well, right? So the longer that a peacekeeping mission is there, then you would expect more of a reduction. If it's actually about this kind of behavioral effect of really deterring a type of violence. So I don't know how you can get at that at all with this setup, but that's something that might be useful to speak to.
Thank you. Those are all really helpful suggestions. So, and I think at least some of them I can visualize right now how we might throw those in, and some others maybe with some thought. So thank you.
And hopefully quickly, right? Yeah, that you don't have to work too hard on them. Sabrina had two fingers too.
Yeah, I actually really like Emily's idea about the variance. It's clever. If you could do that, that would be cool. And actually kind of innovative too. I don't think I've seen a peacekeeping paper where they've kind of demonstrated the importance of the change in that way. So that'd be cool. I did want to caution a little bit about the long term. So it is also possible that you could see an increase in sexual violence as time goes on because reporting gets better. I know that it's a fuzzy line between conflict and post-conflict, but if we go by the UCDP PRIO kind of definition in the data set, which may or may not, you know, there's pluses and benefits of doing that. But I do think the mechanisms are different, and that line can be very fuzzy, but I just think that there's a lot of different things that happen once a negotiated settlement is actually, you know, formed and there's a bargain and the peacekeeping mission comes after that versus if they come in before that bargain is made.
So can I ask a quick question? We control for whether or not there's a ceasefire. Would you like to see an additional control for something else, like whether or not there's a formal agreement?
Yeah, or you know, you could also maybe think about an interaction as well with that. Yeah, I mean, a ceasefire is different than negotiated settlement. So yeah, I just think about it a little bit more.
So I have a question to stimulate some comments maybe. So we are well aware that Shanna and Adam would like to get this out fairly soon, right? It's been ruminating for a while and needs to do some work on someone else's desk. So my question is, you guys have made lots and lots of really good suggestions, and I think that they're all really useful, but some of them can be done while they're in revision or waiting to get their reviews back. And some of them are things that are probably going to make reviewers ding them, right? So of the things that we've talked about today, what are the, like, what's the, like, one thing that if you were a reviewer would make you, you know, think about a hard R&R or even a rejection? Like, what are the things that they are probably going to need to address in order to get an R&R?
I can start. So I think just streamlining the mechanisms would be my, and tying them to sexual violence and not bargaining would be my thing.
Yeah, I think your framing. I think you've got a potentially great hook here and you need to use it. And then the mechanisms. And if you could throw in a theory that actually really supports your mechanisms, that would be even better.
Michael.
Yeah, I'd say the same in terms of mechanisms, and then just add the specificity on the dependent variable. You know, really sell why you're taking the approach you are.
Awesome. So it seems like the biggest issues are conceptual and theoretical, and so all of this tweaking of the empirical models is super useful. But you could also, you know, do it in an appendix as while it's under review.
Thank you.
Awesome. Do we have any last thoughts that you guys want to make sure you get in, either discussants or authors?
I mean, Emily, you stole my question, right, which was, what do we really need to prioritize? But I think there's a lot of interesting food for thought here, and definitely some stuff that we can work on over the next month or two. So, Adam, do you have anything else that you definitely want feedback on?
No, I think that last question was what I was really looking for.
Awesome. Well, thank you to everyone. Thank you for Shanna and Adam for sharing this paper with us. If anyone wants to, who's watching, you know, is coming in late, you should go back and rewatch it and check out the presentation. And the paper is linked to the Online Peace Science Society website. And so anyone can read it and comment on it and send Shanna and Adam your questions and comments and email. I'd really like to thank our discussants, Sabrina, Michael, and Susanna for joining us today. Those were excellent comments and really helpful. So thank you for taking the time to read the paper and to join us today. And thanks to all for a lively discussion. It was awesome.
Thank you guys very much.
Yeah.
Absolutely. You're very welcome. Thank you.